And tonight you're in for a treat. It's a multifaceted program with things that you can get your hands dirty with, as well as to brainstorm with us. You're in for a ride for tonight. And now, without further ado, we're going to watch a quick video before we sink into the rest of the program. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us. I'm LaToya Edwards.
And I'm meteorologist Tevin Wooten. Welcome to the Heat Is On Environmental Racism. Massachusetts has a name for places that we just described, environmental justice communities.
Nearly half of Massachusetts residents live in impacted neighborhoods. In Boston, those communities include much of Dorchester, Mattapan, Roxbury, and East Boston.
Many residents here are plagued by severe asthma, diabetes, hypertension, and other chronic conditions.
And now they are trying to fight back.
You can smell the pollution on you.
This area becomes like this unique nexus of economic injustice meets environmental degradation.
Latifa Zaire is on a mission, empowering residents and businesses to protect themselves from hazardous air. And her work with the Neighborhood of Affordable Housing, or NOAA.
Kisses.
As a result, people like Lisi and her four children have a new tool at home, this high-end air filter.
You can have a better life inside in your home. When you go outside, you feel tired. When you come in here, inside, you feel better, breathe better.
Businesses like Spinelli's, an East Boston fixture, also benefit from this work.
Our air quality definitely needed some improvement. So much of what happens on the streets, you think behind closed doors and with implementation of HVAC that you're safe from that, but that's not necessarily the case.
Latifa and NOAA offered an air monitor.
This is our special sensor because it's got our solar paneling.
A deeply discounted high-end air filter for about $350, or a homemade alternative for about $100. It's a program NOAA hopes to expand.
My hope is, wherever you're at, to give you enough tools to be able to have the kind of quality of life that everyone deserves when they were born on this planet. To be equitable in the end, you actually have to be unequitable in the process, because there's been so much degradation of resource over such a long time that you actually have to put heavy work into spaces that haven't gotten the love.
Yeah, a lot of insightful information. Yes. It's going to be a tough hill to climb, too. We want to dig a little bit deeper now into the impact of the environment on health.
You bet. Oops, is this on?
Yes!
Leave it to Latifa to just explain it how it is. And only Latifa can make something like air quality really fun. So, thanks for all the party vibes at the beginning. He'll like to come on in a second. Anthony's doing everything tonight. Let's hear it for Anthony. Pretty much summed up why we're here tonight. We are an environmental justice community that is burdened by heavy air pollution exposure. And if you want to start the slides, Anthony, whenever you have a free hand. Air pollution comes from any source that burns fossil fuels. Locally, that mostly means gas stoves, which we're going to talk about later as a health impact. But our biggest source of pollution is Logan Airport and related car traffic. Next one. Great. So we're really here tonight because of these little guys, particulate matter and ultrafine particulates, pollution particles. They're so small that they enter the blood-brain barrier and get into our organs, and that's particularly unnerving for parents with little kids. You can see the width of a human hair is right here. 10 micrometers and above are those little blue dots. 2.5 micrometers and above are the little yellow ones going around the blue dots. That's the smallest particle that EPA regulates. And then above that is what we're talking about with ultrafine particles, the little red ring around the yellow. So it's like this smallest thing we can imagine, and they do a lot to us. They have a lot of power. Next slide. UFPs are the single largest driver of serious health effects in high transportation communities like ours, and they have a lot of health impacts on us. For kids, health impacts are asthma, lost in IQ, autism, low birth weight, and obesity, amongst some. For adults, asthma, COPD, early onset dementia, stroke, cancer, obesity, and premature birth among pregnant women. Fun. And East Boston has the highest percentage of children in all of Boston at 21%. So this is a big deal for our kids. And just to give you an example of what we're exposed to, I love this statistic. When we are downwind of a plane taking off or landing, concentrations of those tiny ultrafine particles reach what we've experienced standing in the middle of I-93 rush hour times 10. And none of us would want our kids to be in the middle of that. Next slide. So it's been hard to paint the story of our true air pollution exposure because we haven't historically had good air quality monitoring. The closest airport-sponsored EPA sensor is in Nubian Square, and it might be tricky to see, but that's 4.5 miles away from us. That sensor only captures data once every hour, so when we have planes taking off every 30 seconds, that's not really telling us much of a picture of what we're really exposed to. And that sensor doesn't capture ultrafines, only particulate matter 2.5 and above. And why that is because the EPA doesn't regulate ultrafines, as we mentioned. Next slide. It's difficult to make changes because Logan Airport and the FAA, the Federal Aviation Administration, answer to the EPA, the big government entity that creates these standards. And many of us in this room would say that the EPA doesn't have stringent standards enough. Next slide. I asked Chris Markey for a visual on how to explain the difference between EPA standards and World Health Organization standards, because I've seen visuals where the World Health Organization says, your kid should only be exposed to like this much pollution. And then you look at the EPA standards and it's like, no, your kids can be exposed to this, it's fine. So Chris sent me this picture. And just an example, the WHO's maximum noise metrics are 50 times lower than the United States EPA standards. Next slide. We're in an exciting new phase, though, of air quality monitoring, thanks to Aaron and environmental engineers in the room tonight. They've been using cutting-edge technology in our Logan community that monitors ultrafines, and this monitor network extends within the 2-mile radius of our community. So when some of us live less than a mile from the runway, that's what we need. We need sensors right here in our midst. And I'm going to invite Cindy, wherever she is, to come up and talk to us a little bit more about the health impacts. So Cindy, as the teacher mentioned, is from Clean Water Action. She rides the line of legislation and health like no other, I think. So she's going to talk a little more about the health impacts.
Hey, everybody. How are you doing? Air pollution is fascinating, isn't it? So, this is diving a little bit deeper into some of what Sonia was talking about. And honestly, when I think about air pollution, I think about stuff, you know, that you can see, like plumes coming out of a big smokestack or soot coming out of a tailpipe. But here's the tricky part. The air pollution that we're talking about tonight is so teeny that you can't see it with the human eye. So it's sort of an invisible burden that we deal with. And it very quickly becomes the pollution inside us because, as Sonia mentioned, it's so small, it passes through our body's defenses and lodges in our lungs and in our organs. So this here is a sampling of what different air pollutants can do. And I think we're all very smart to be concerned and to be fighting for healthier air. Who here wants cleaner air for your kids? I love it. Who doesn't have any indoor? Seriously? Okay. Okay. Fair enough. health. So nitrogen oxides, they contribute to the development and also to distress for people who have asthma. They can bring on asthma attacks. Some of you may have seen on the news when they talk about a bad air day in the summer when you can, you know, practically chew on the air. It's hot and, you know, it's smoggy. That is one of the pollutants that is in the mix, contributing to ground level ozone. So nitrogen oxides are a big problem for us. And who here, just curious, who here has asthma or knows of someone with asthma? Or, you know, anyone with breathing problems. It's an awful feeling to be with someone who's struggling to breathe. And some of this can be very controlled with medications and with, you know, not being next to things you're allergic to, that kind of thing. But air pollution, outdoor air pollution in particular, is something that we all have to work on so everyone can have the right to breathe easy. So nitrogen oxides, very significant. Carbon monoxide, I think many of us have carbon monoxide monitors inside our homes. These are often shorter term, kind of acute responses that we get from a health perspective to carbon monoxide. High levels can lead to terrible outcomes. Really work to control these. And PM2.5, that sort of medium level teeny soot that Sonia was talking about, not like the teeniest, but very small. This is the one that there's so much research on, health research that points to lots of impacts here in Massachusetts. A few years ago, researchers looked at the entire state and analyzed, I think this was 2019, that PM2.5 levels of pollution were attributing to nearly 3,000 premature deaths every single year. For the year 2019, this was before COVID, that was about 5% of the deaths, cause of deaths in Massachusetts, premature deaths. So PM2.5 is very, very significant. And all of these are caused by burning what?
Fossil
fuels. So remember that, because we need to talk more about that when we talk about legislation. Okay, next. And there are smaller lines that we have to be worried about, especially. And some of this is because kids are smaller than adults, so pollution impacts them more proportionally. Some of this is because kids' defense mechanisms aren't quite as developed as adults. So kids have higher breathing rates, greater levels of physical activity, and they haven't quite developed all their body systems. So next slide. So we're particularly worried about clean air for our kids. And this is some of the impacts that air pollution, particularly nitrogen oxides, can have on kids. I think the one that surprises people most is the impact on IQ, because I don't know, you typically think about air pollution, you think about lungs, or maybe your heart, but can also impact brain and brain function and the ability to pay attention and the ability to retain information. So these are some of the building blocks of what makes a successful life for kids. And we really want to protect every one of those IQ points. So we're particularly concerned about that. Also, as the climate crisis continues to build and we have warmer and sometimes terribly hot weather, there's greater amounts of allergens in our world, more pollen, and these are the kind of pollutants that also make kids more susceptible to developing allergies. So all of this is good motivation to work for cleaner air. I think that's it. Okay. So, yay for clean air, and I'm so happy to see everyone. about what we can do about it to keep fighting for better air quality.
Thank you, Cindy. Chris Rocky with Airport Impact Relief Incorporated. Okay, so I want to take a look at that image there. It's really important. There's so many questions that people will have about the airport and about Massport and how we can be so deranged as to be doing the things we're doing, polluting the neighborhoods around the airport as badly as we are. And one of the reasons I think that's important to understand is that the Port Authority was created with broad powers. So I have a little bit of a thing I'm going to read to you here. And let me ask you this. What would happen if you gave a government agency unlimited power and money? Oh, sorry. That's not a problem with me. So what would happen if you gave a government agency unlimited power and money? Around here, we can answer that question because our legislature created Massport to take over Logan, and it did just that. It gave them unlimited funding and power. They have the power of eminent domain. They have the power to do whatever they want. So what did they do with that power? They expanded Logan. Next slide. There's another fun graphic from the 70s showing them as an evil octopus that expands over the entire neighborhood. Next slide. So what did they do with that power? They expanded Logan by destroying three harbor islands with 80 acres of land and another 1,500 acres of tidelands. Slide. They expanded Logan by destroying 87 acres of parks, including Boston's only saltwater Olmsted Park and Emerina Field, which was a baseball field off of Maverick Street and Jeffers Point. Next slide, please. They expanded Logan by destroying two East Boston neighborhoods, flattening hundreds of homes and businesses, next slide, and a vegetable market to build the East Boston Expressway in Summer and Callahan Tunnels. Massport says that Logan brings billions in economic activity to the state, but it also brings 35,000 pounds of EPA criteria pollutants, and 143,000 cars, and 195 nighttime flights every single day to East Boston. In 2018, Logan's five most active airlines made over $11.5 billion in profit. The airlines have influenced Washington's politics and shaped the legal and federal FAA regulatory systems to promote growth for air travel, and they don't want to pay for environmental damage that their industry causes. Next slide, please. Airport owners like Massport play for the airline team, building runways, roadways, terminals, and other facilities the airlines need, often using public money. The result is an open door for air travel growth and profit, and regulations that allow pollution to grow without constraint. Now, Massport keeps telling everyone that things are getting better and they're doing lots of great stuff. They literally say, we're doing lots of good stuff, right? So I've got a little demonstration. I'm going to ask a few of the high school students who are here today in the audience to come down and help me with a little art project that I've demonstrated. You guys come on up here. Don't be shy. So this is all live. They haven't done this before. Neither have I. So what we're going to do is we're going to start out and have one of you guys. You want to be the leader? You can just grab this here. Now just hold this here. And when I tell you to stop walking, we'll have an expert. Why don't you have some other people come over here? And you're going to go down this line here. That's right. And just spread up. Okay, go. Thank you. Let's see if this works.
Your rental card.
All right, so we're going to use nitrous oxides. Now, Cindy told you a little bit about nitrous oxides, right? NOx or NO2, they're called interchangeably, and Wick could, and Evan can tell you more about that. If Massport did every single thing it could do to control the sources of nitrous oxide that Massport owns and controls themselves. Can you guys hear me?
Yeah.
This would be the amount. This represents the amount of all the things Massport can do. That includes Logan's heating and cooling equipment for all their terminals. Oh, you're the best. Logan's heating and cooling equipment for all their terminals would fit into this space right here. Their snow melting equipment, their emergency generators, and all the other sources that the Port Authority itself owns and operates would fit in this box. So let's say they could reduce this by half. Now this amount here is equal to 700 pounds a day of pollution. So if they could reduce that by half, that'd be great, wouldn't it? They could cut down maybe 350 pounds of pollution every day from emitting that into the air. But what we want to do is we want to look at the fact that the stuff that Massport controls is so minute, it's about 5% of the total daily pollution. So what we're going to do is I'm going to ask you to start, pick that up by the bottom and start walking. And start walking outward with it. Hopefully this will just keep walking that way. Okay. So what happens when we build more terminals? Now, why don't you come and grab this and hold it up for the crowd? See how it's falling? Hold that up. Yep. Keep going. We're building terminals and car facilities and more terminals and roadways. Okay, stop there for a second. Now that's the amount of pollution, which in 2019, that's 35,000 pounds of pollution. And this is the amount of pollution that the Port Authority actually has control over. So let me get back to my script here. They don't control the airlines and the aircraft, right? But they do build the terminals, and they build the parking garages, right? They build the roadways so that they open up the door for more pollution. And as they increase the capacity of Logan, the pollution they don't control rises. So here's the biggest problem. Massport is planning to add a fifth fuel storage tank, which is going to hold another 1.8 million gallons of fuel. And that storage tank is planned to be about 480 feet away from the East Boston Public Library.
Ooh.
And it's South Academy. Okay? They're planning to build a runway safety area that extends out over the harbor and kills more of the ocean. They're doing everything they possibly can, and their friends are helping them too. The East Boston Harbor, has anybody heard of the East Boston Harbor? This is a concept of building a road that leads to private land off the airport where we'll have cargo facilities and flight kitchens. What happens when we move all the flight kitchens and cargo facilities off the airport? We'll allow the airport to expand again. In the last 10 years, Logan expanded by 40% to get to this level. What happens if we were to try to expand again? Can you see if you can find, we're out of space on the stage, can you keep walking? Go down the stairs. What's going to happen if, when Terminal E opens, when the fuel tank is built, when the roadways are all reconfigured? You guys can stay. Just keep going. There you go. In the next 10 years, we're going to have another 40% of pollution. And this was the stuff that, in the next 5 years, let's say, Massport could control. So that's a demonstration I wanted to give you guys today about, hopefully it helps. Listen, the next 40%, that they're going to have here, it might bring 40% more economic activity to the state, right? Maybe it'd be 40% more convenient for air travel, some frequent flyers, right? But it's also going to have 40% more MOX, 40% more carbon monoxide, 40% more nighttime noise flights, right? And 40% more maybe 40% more asthma for kids. So it's really important that we all get together as a community and we start to recognize that this is a massive airport expansion era that we're in the middle of right now, and we need to stop it. So that's Aaron Spitt. Thank you guys. Good morning, Boston. Boston, Boston.
Thank you, Aaron.
And now I don't know what to do with this.
All right. My name is Evan,
hey!
And And let me just say, I'm in awe of what you all have put together. And I'm very, very privileged to just play a small part in all this. I'm just standing in front of my slides so you can't see them. I'm standing here representing not only Quantiq, which is a company that I did found with my good friend David Hagen almost 4 years ago. But what preceded the formation of our company was some really awesome, critical, local community air monitoring work that we did in collaboration with Scott Hersey at Olin College. And that even preceded Scott's formation of Air Partners, which is now a critical player in expanding air quality monitoring for community. So the growth of Quantiq and our ability to enable people to make legit atmospheric chemistry measurements at scale locally is very much a product of what's in this room. So I am deeply indebted to you all for caring. So what can we actually do about it? If you want to go ahead, let's see where this goes. 2019 is the official launch of when Scott and I went out and deployed a handful of sensors around Logan. Those sensors ran for 3 years continuously in these locations. Since then, there have been many, many expansions. But this is the core effort that we put together in the early days, and that was in collaboration with Eric. Eric put $15,000 on the table. We came up with what we needed to come up with to build this thing, and we bootstrapped it into reality. So, what does that mean? What's the next thing we can do? We can take a look at this map. We can put dots on the map for the positions of this thing. And this thing right here, this is the thing that measures particulate matter. It measures, and it differentiates the size of the particulate matter that we're measuring. It cannot measure those ultrafine particles. Because to do that for $1,500, which is what this box costs, is impossible right now. It doesn't mean that we're not working on it. And it doesn't mean we can't learn really important things with this box. So that shaded area is when the altitude of the aircraft is below 200 feet in altitude. And that's important to you because that means it's super loud. It also means that the airplane has to push down in order to stay aloft, hits the surface. And that air has a ton of particles in it. The really tiny ones that Galaxy and Wake have been talking about for decades. And the UFPs that we just heard about. So everywhere there's a gray shade and there's a super concentrated aircraft flying, you have a curtain of air pollution that hits the surface. So the question is, can we measure that? And can we actually begin to tell a story about how air pollution is unequally distributed around these communities and subsets of community. So let's see, where's the next slide? All right, so we can start to do this even with the limited tools that we have. And we can see these sorts of images emerge where you see red stuff and blue stuff. This is just plotting NO2. Measured with the slightly larger box that we saw. But you can see where Logan is, and you can actually begin to see that the folks that live downwind of 22L&R basically get pummeled with NO2. And this is obvious. People who live there can tell you. They don't need a sensor to tell it. But the NO2 that happens in that location looks, feels, that impact is dramatically different than people who are actually in Jeffrey's Point, where most of the NO2 comes from the port, not from the airport. That's an important distinction. And that's largely because of the wind. In April, the winds shift and you guys get pummeled with terminal A, which smells like garbage, in Jeffrey's Point. But most of the rest of the year, you guys are upwind. But there's a bunch of dirty ships that happen to be upwind of you. So we need to be able to have a lot of nuance sort of built into our ability to map air pollution to differentiate these sources so that we can tell unambiguous pollution stories and talk about these differences. Because I had a meeting with MassDEP earlier today in person, and they said the thing we care about is talking about the differences. They don't necessarily, they're motivated to hit environmental justice now. I don't know if y'all know this, but EPA has to spend $2.8 billion on environmental justice between today and September of 2026. They have to. And that, my friends, has never happened before. Not by an order of magnitude or two, right? So there are resources that are going to hit, but we need to use them to basically help communities tell unambiguous air pollution stories. And that's sort of my whole shit, my whole passion in life, is how can we actually tell people what they're actually breathing and where it comes from? And then, can we devise mitigation strategies that actually help them breathe less pollution? Can we do it? Can we do it without the politicians? Because frankly, that's your power. Your power is those devices that filter in the back of the room. That's your power tomorrow. You can build one and put it in your kid's bedroom, and they will breathe 90% fewer ultrafine particles tomorrow night. And that's awesome! But it also sucks. It also sucks! Because that shouldn't necessarily be your responsibility. Alright. You can do this for all types of different pollutants. You can see the same stories emerge, slightly different stories. If we look at NO, that's a thing that also comes out of aircraft engines. You can start to see the terminal signal coming in on those aprils, those winds that come from that direction. You can see that the concentration of these plumes, the structure of the plumes, it looks different depending on the pollutant. And this has to do with how aircraft engines emit different stuff, whether they're at 100% power or at 4% power. Because you'll get a taxiing line of aircraft that are just idling, and the emissions that come out of those engines are totally different than the emissions when it's going at 100% power on takeoff. So we gotta play some nuanced air pollution games to really understand these impacts, but the impacts are real and they're measurable. Next. If we look at it in time, this is where it gets tricky. I know these kind of graphs don't really make sense to most humans on planet Earth, but these are where I live and breathe and think about. This axis over here is how much stuff, whether it's NO or NO2. And that's just a blown up region of like 60 minutes. That's just 60 minutes. Every single little plume you see there, that's an individual aircraft taking off in 2012. Okay, so we can literally count airplanes. And we can see that a couple of those airplanes actually emit 4 or 5 times as much NOx as some of the other airplanes. Guess what? That's an interesting piece of information. There's nothing to stop us from looking at the logs and actually tagging every single one of those plumes with the actual aircraft engine that took off at that time. We have all that data. The question is sort of, what do we do with it? Does it matter? Because these concentration levels, despite the fact that these are 5 to 10 times higher than what we see 30 meters off I-93, they're still lower than the legal limit. I hate to break it to you, Logan's not breaking any laws. These aircraft engine companies, they're not breaking the law, even for people who live on Bayview. Which sucks, because their concentrations that they're breathing are literally 10, 100 times higher than the normal background. And we know precisely why, but the legal framework around which we do something about that, from a policy level, is somewhat weak. So, things that are so super obvious to your intuition, you can smell the plume, you know it makes you feel like garbage, and you know what's causing it, you end up being able to use this data to understand frequency, magnitude, duration of events, and maybe we can build a narrative around that to talk about unequal air across the domain. And that, I think, is going to motivate the politicians in a way that, yeah, we're still under the legal limit, but who cares? Let's deal with the differences that actually exist. Okay, I'm already taking way too much time, I'm sorry. The last piece that I'll tell you is, like, my dream is that these boxes can measure everything that is most important, which would be ultrafines, it would be black carbon, it would be speciated VOCs, which is a fancy science way of saying cancer. I can't do that for $1,000 yet. I can deploy periodically a $25,000 instrument that does measure ultrafines, and I can show you that the story in Bayesview is backed up by what we see in the NOx traces. So the top traces are the things I can measure right now for low cost. And the middle one, that's black carbon. It's gonna take about $8,000 to $10,000 for me to measure black carbon. And it's gonna take me about $30,000 to measure the ultrafines. But they're all telling you a story. They're telling you pieces of the same story. And in fact, does anybody have any clue why the black carbons would be sharp and the ultrafines would be sort of smeary and broad? They don't look exactly the same. Why? They blow around, maybe. Gosh, it's been a while since I've been in front of a room. I feel like I've been in my office like for 3.5 years. 7 minutes. Yeah, this is like minute 21 of this presentation. All right, I'll cut to the chase. The reason black carbon is sharp, comes up and down fast, is that's what comes out at 100% power. But guess what comes out at both 4% power and 100% power? The ultrafines. So all of the aircraft that are idling, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 aircraft, just sitting on the runway, tarmac, trying to do that U-turn so that they can take off, they're all emitting ultrafines, and those are sweeping over Bayesview at idle in a similar way to them sweeping over Bayesview at 100% power. Okay, so you just went, the difference between the black line and the red line is a pollutant that comes out more or less all the time the aircraft is off of the terminal, APU power, versus something that only comes out of the aircraft when you need the aircraft to go really, really fast so they can fly in the air. So that's neat, that's really neat. And that begins to tell us clues about, hey, guess what, Logan? Maybe we take a Chris's example here is brilliant, right? Because what Chris is saying is there's only so much that's inside of Massport's control. And even if they eliminated all of it, it wouldn't matter. But guess what? Massport can change the way aircraft stay on APU power or sit on the runway for 15 minutes at idle. And guess what? That would dramatically change the black line in this graph. And then you probably change that without having an economic downside to the operation of the airport. Do you think anybody at Massport is smart enough to know the difference between the black line and the red line? No. Not until they buy some of these sensors and put them all over that airport. Right? So let's figure out a way to do this. And basically, the last thing I wanted to say was this is what's really exciting. We started here, me and Scott and that loud guy over there and Gail, who still wants to wring my neck. And we did it in 2019. If you advance the slide, you know, we are continuing to build networks. Just in Boston alone, and you can just go through the next, and then next, and then one more maybe. Oh no, go back. animations in PowerPoint. So 1995. What's super exciting here is that partnering with our partners basically allows us to access a whole bunch of different air pollution questions. And we can scale. And we can take what started with 8 nodes in AirInc, and we literally are on the cusp of having 300 of these systems in and around Boston deployed and pumping 1 minute data, you know, by the end of April. And that is a big deal because it's all happening through and by community, and no regulators are paying for it. No policymakers are paying for it. Not yet. And we're basically building the most legit distributed air quality monitoring infrastructure that exists in the United States of America. Woo! Through you guys. That's a big deal. And the end of this is actually what it's all about, which is actually delivering solutions that lower the particle concentration in your indoor environments. And we can do it with DIY solutions that, frankly, can outcompete the Austin Air, and we know that now. But we can do it with commercial solutions. You know, there's a bunch of take-homes that you won't be able to see because of the image, but just take my word for it. Hit me up, ask me questions, I'm happy to help.
To enhance air quality. You know, we heard a lot about the incredible work that grassroots organizers are doing to address air quality in our neighborhood, but we also want to make sure that we're working to provide the legal frameworks that sustain structural change that makes it so that we're, you know, solidifying these efforts and not relying on sort of grassroots change to provide the things that everybody should be entitled to. So, you know, we really want to thank everybody for all of their efforts, and of course those grassroots efforts have been influencing Representative Madera's legislation and informing the way that we do our work. So tonight I'm going to be hearing from Stephen, my amazing colleague, who's going to be walking you through his legislative agenda regarding environmental justice, and I'll let him take it over.
Thanks, Laura. And you know, everyone, Rev Monroe really wishes that he could have been here tonight to present to you himself. He wouldn't have needed this microphone. Very fortunately, he's not here because his family just expanded. The Monroe family recently welcomed a new baby about 4 days ago now. He's a little one named Nico. And, you know, he reminded us of exactly why we're doing this work, because this is all about the future of our youth here in East Boston. So, the first step on this journey I'm going to talk about is the environmental justice law that we passed a few years ago. So we filed this in 2019, and environmental justice law, this affected the whole state. So basically what this bill did is it defined environmental justice in law for the first time in state history. And in addition to that, it provides the definitions of exactly what an environmental justice community is, defining it by race, income status, I believe language. So East Boston fits all of those metrics. We are definitely one of the state's biggest environmental justice communities. And third, it created procedural protections for environmental justice communities when new projects that could potentially pollute are introduced in a community like ours. It creates greater protections and a stronger public process. So we passed this into law in early 2021 as part of a larger climate omnibus. This was huge, it was also really fast. Most legislation does not happen in 2 years. This really did. And it was the first big victory in the fight for environmental justice. It has huge statewide impact that we are already seeing. But after this, you know, we decided, okay, we did this big statewide change. Now we want to take a look at some of the specific issues that we're facing here in our environmental justice community of East Boston, and what we can do to address those. And obviously, one of the biggest is Logan Airport. So, because of that, we have filed a new bill. This bill was it was done in collaboration with, as Gloribel said, a lot of community grassroots organizations, AIR and Mothers Out Front, Professor Hersey and the Olin AIR Strategies Group. You know, they sat down, they worked with us, they helped us understand the science a lot, and the result of that was an act improving air quality in airport and environmental justice communities. That's the current docket number. We first introduced it the last legislative session, and we just reintroduced it for this legislative session in January. So essentially, this bill has a number of pillars designed to both help us understand pollution at the airport, make Massport act on it and also mitigate against it. So the first big pillar is essentially we want Massport to create a strategy report that talks about, you know, all right, we want to take a look at what would be the acceptable noise levels, what would be the acceptable air quality levels, and, you know, we want those standards and we want a pathway for you to work towards that. And every so often, the airport is, Massport is going to have to review that and see, okay, are we on track? Are we getting towards those benchmarks? If we're not, it requires an action plan. That Massport has to lay out an action plan that, you know, essentially says how they plan to get that, specific benchmarks, timetables. We want, you know, we want details, we want concrete action. And of course, if Massport doesn't do that, because, you know, we're not always so trusting that they're going to be, you know, proactive on this, then the bill says that MassDEP is going to make them do it, essentially. It takes over oversight of that and directs them to do this. So that's kind of the big top one. And of course, there's going to be public process and public input through all of that, because obviously we want the community to be, you know, giving that input on what those levels should look like. So the second part, go back. The second part is that we want Massport to conduct regular health studies in the airport. So as some of you, as a lot of you may know, about 10 years ago in 2014, Massport did conclude a legislatively mandated and funded health study at the airport. The health study gave us a lot of important data on how the airport contributes to health, childhood asthma, things like COPD, but it left a lot of gaps too, and it was also only a one-time thing. So our bill says you have to do this every 10 years, and it also kind of ups the requirements on that to make it a little bit more stringent, a little bit more informative. And we are going to be establishing more air quality and noise level monitoring around Logan Airport. And the final thing is that, as you heard today, we have these little particulates called ultrafine particulates. They're a big problem. Nobody measures them. The EPA doesn't measure them, and the state DEP doesn't measure them, which means the Massport doesn't measure them because nobody's measuring them and nobody requires them to. So our bill is going to require that MassDEP start to measure ultrafine particulates. We're going to require that they actually start taking these measurements. And so that will not only be a requirement of Massport, that will be a statewide requirement. So we've already done a little bit of work on this. So when the bill was filed last session, we had a few other things in there about air sensors and about filters. So in the FY23 budget last year, we secured about $150,000 for the state to install three of their air quality monitoring stations in East Boston. That is a huge win. Now, it's not originally what we were going for. Originally, we were going for kind of small, like a network of smaller monitors, kind of like you just saw. We talked to DEP, DEP's like, yeah, we don't really do that. We kind of use these air quality monitors. These are the ones you can get funding for. So we did, we're getting three of them. That is still, if you take a look at these monitors around the state, we are going to have the most monitors anywhere in this state. And you saw before, the closest one to us right now is in Nubian Square. So this is we're going to have the most anywhere in the state, the highest concentration. Obviously, we still want more to do. When we passed the budget last year, DEP was under a different governor. We have a new governor now. Maybe there can be some wiggle room. But you know, right now that's where things stand. And originally the bill included a component requiring air filters in public schools, but of course, Boston Public Schools, as you know, has already installed air filters. Now we're going to talk a little bit about that. The air filters they installed aren't quite everything that we want. There's still a lot more progress we want to see there, but they are around. So we've kind of taken the step of these two pillars don't exist in the legislation right now. We're kind of exploring other pathways to get them done through talking to the administration, through getting things in the budget. And so these are sort of existing currently in alternative pathways that may eventually find their way back to legislation. But right now, we're getting them accomplished in other ways. And then We filed the ultra-fine particulate bill. Also, it's in the larger airport EJ bill, but we filed it separately so that it also has a chance to move independently of the airport bill, because obviously up at the State House, we are dealing with a bunch of legislators from other communities. You know, if you're a legislator from Worcester, if you're a legislator from Lowell, whatever, you might not really care about what's happening in the environment in these spots, and that might not really matter to you. But ultra-fine particulates exist in a lot of places. They come off of highways, they come off of all sorts of industrial uses, etc. And so this is a bill that can really appeal to everyone statewide. And so filing it separately kind of lets us market it that way to the other legislators. And then finally, we have a little surprise for you. We are introducing a new piece of legislation. It hasn't been filed yet. We're still getting the final language decided, but it should be filed within the next couple weeks. This is our new fair jet fuel tax bill. So right now, I bet you didn't know, airline companies pay less gas tax than you do. If you have a car, I assume not all of you do, but if you have a car, airline companies pay less gas tax than you do. The jet fuel tax, it's a weird metric, but right now it stands at about 17 cents per gallon. The gas tax for your car in Massachusetts is 24 cents a gallon. So why they're paying less than you, I don't really know. We don't really think that they should. So basically what our bill is going to do is introduce an additional tax on jet fuel that will bring the total tax up to the same as a car, 24 cents a gallon. And essentially what we're going to be doing with that extra money is it's going to go towards a climate resiliency trust fund that is going to essentially be administered by Massport. Not necessarily our first choice, but there are certain federal rules that mean that Massport has to administer this. And that fund's going to be used to pursue climate resiliency projects, pursue their net zero emissions plans, basically to make the airport, and as a result, East Boston, more emissions-friendly, more climate-friendly, and, you know, and improve the health and air quality in East Boston. So that is where our legislative agenda currently stands. We appreciate your help and support on this, and we'll let you know as these things move through the legislature.
So, we mentioned you had a job here tonight, and those are those postcards that you saw when you came in, because part of why we gave those to you is because we need to collect community testimony for these important pieces of legislation. So by you giving us your stories and how we can find you to tell your story again later through testimony, is really important. We need a lot of community involvement to get these passed. So we just have two quick things for you left before we have time for a little question and answer. We don't have time, but and breakout rooms. So as Mothers Out Front East Boston, we wanted to, if you keep going forward, we have been proclaiming a campaign to get HEPA filters into all spaces where kids are. That's because as a mom, you can't wait for the airplanes to be electrified. Is that the right word? We can't wait for electric planes. It's too long. Our kids are going to grow up with way too much pollution exposure. So we want something now, and that answer is a high-quality HEPA filter. So, next slide. Why is that? Because we know they can reduce exposure up to 95%. Filters and HVAC systems, filters placed on HVAC systems aren't enough. That's because the filters only work when air is forced through the HVAC system. And when you have a plane taking off every 30 seconds, you want round-the-clock protection for your kids. So we need those plug-in filters. And we also know that 70% of outdoor pollution makes it inside, which I don't think has been said yet today, but 70% of the pollution outside makes it indoors, which is huge. There's also robust studies out there saying that HEPA filters are the most cost-effective way to close the achievement gap. The current filters in the schools, which Stephen touched on, They were placed there for COVID. They're good filters, but they're not our solution here in East Boston long term. That's because you need to replace the filter every 4 months, which is a huge financial and personnel burden for facilities. The Austin Air, for example, lasts for 10 years with one filter replacement at 5 years. The other reason they're not ideal, and if we have teachers here tonight, hopefully you know this, because we've been trying to do a big push to let teachers know to turn off the ionizing feature on those filters. Ionizing features release ozone, which can aggravate asthmatic symptoms for kids with asthma, and they have been linked to increase in hospitalization. So we don't want that in our kids' classrooms. If it's turned off, great, it will not affect the performance of the filter. So we think most teachers know this by now, but teachers in the room, please turn off the ionizing feature. Next slide. To further protect our littlest kids, we got a clean air grant this year to put HEPA filters into all home daycares. So this has served about 35 daycares, 250 kids. And Belinda's gonna just share with you some of the feedback from the providers.
Yeah, I'm really happy because I get to share the good news after you all hear the bad news. So the first example of feedback that we got on the next slide, or next few slides. Oh, that's me. That's me with the daycare provider that my youngest goes to. If you go to the next slide, you'll see some pictures of other daycare centers, and I mean at-home daycare centers, and what it looks like inside. And then if you go maybe like two slides. Thank you, Anthony. So the first one, originally in Spanish, but translated. So the filter has really been of great benefit, since it purifies the air, and children with health problems have improved remarkably. I have my 12-year-old granddaughter at home who has asthma, and it has helped her a lot. Since I got the filter, she has not had severe episodes. For our program, it has been a great blessing. It's helped my children to rest better at bedtime, since by purifying the air, they don't cough as much. And with that, I'll hand it over back to you, Sonia, to talk about what's up next. Oh, I will hand it over to Latifa to talk about what's next.
Hi. We are running a few minutes behind, so we're going to try to catch up really quick if we want to really experience the breakout sessions. All right, so many of you may know that the Neighborhood of Affordable Housing, NOAA, got a grant last year for
clean air grant
for $50,000. And in that grant, what it allowed us to do was to go to 30 residents and 10 businesses and place a Austin Air filter like you've heard here today. And we also did some purple filters as well, because people have small apartments in East Boston, and those things are huge. And so some people just didn't want it at home. And we tried to deal with it on the kind of cultural space where we said, you know, let people get in where they fit in, right? And then once they get used to that and acclimated to it, then they can try something else later. So we didn't want to force fit it. It worked for us. It helped our budget. And it also meant that we gave most people those Austin Airs and a few people something different. And actually, when you talk to some of the other people, the first couple of months, it's got a similar level of filtration. It doesn't have as much of an expansive reach within space. But if we're talking about smaller spaces, it may not be as important. What we found from that was that when people cook, essentially, we saw spikes that hit the EPA, emergency levels on a day-to-day basis several times a day. When they got up in the middle of the night and they scuttled to the bathroom, we saw scuttles going through the house. And what we found was we were looking for airplanes. That's what we wrote the grant for, but the technology didn't go for airplanes. It went for the truck traffic outside or the ovens in your house. And so this is kind of like a big snafu almost, right, in terms of what we wrote, but it helped us to learn on the ground. So then what we did is we looked at the data that we got, and we figured out that some of the restaurants really need a lot more ventilation, because those numbers were insane. We found out that in Day Square, we had two businesses. One was a restaurant, one was another business, and a flower shop. And in the restaurant, you could see those peaks, but in the flower shop, it was much lower. But there is something that we were researching, which said that if you have a small apartment, in order to have the same infiltration as a HEPA filter, you had to have 500 plants, which essentially meant you live in the jungle, right? And what we found in Muzzy's, the florist, was that the levels were lower, but they weren't so significantly lower, even at the times in comparison to Day Square and Spinelli's when they were cooking with the oven, right? So the idea that plants make a huge impact comparable to the HEPA filters is really very low, right? So we found out things like that on the ground, and then we went back to the city and we said, well, we found out what happens with trucks, and we found out what happens with gas stoves, and thank God for the neighborhood of affordable housing, we do housing, so we know now we need to focus on taking gas stoves out of the houses we built and re-renovate. But we're still stuck with this problem. We wanted to talk about airplanes, right? So we went back to them and they gave us another $25,000, and then this money, this time, we got black carbon measures, which are now going to be deployed in some of the key areas, and we're going to be able to read those chemicals coming off of the airplanes and give you now data that helps to support what the airplanes are actually doing in the community. So we're really excited about that. That's launching now. We also changed our plan. You see those big, someone point to the big, can do a banner white for me in the back. You see the big box fans out there? We switched from, yes. That's the small one, the big one in the corner. You saw them coming in, you saw those big tape together things and look really nice. We want them in our real living rooms, right? So we got these things, these box fans, that are approved by EPA, and instead of doing the Austin Airs, which cost us $750 without any kind of subsidy, we got these that cost $100, and you can wake up tomorrow and control your space and get a better sense of quality here. And I gotta tell you, from a qualitative perspective, they had that thing glowing in my office, and I did not realize how dead the air was until I got it. Because once they started blowing that thing, all of a sudden I felt like the casino when they blow the oxygen. You know, I was really happy all the time, right? And so those things really do make a difference. And we're gonna have some of those available tonight for folks to walk away with, actually. And we're gonna do an assembly of one so you can see how to assemble it in your own home. And on top of that, we're gonna do our breakouts in several spaces, and Simon's gonna tell you what these breakouts are so you can choose that. And we'll be back with a full report on everything that we're doing coming up soon.
So, yes. So that concludes our time together here for now. I think because of time, what we're gonna have to do is answer our questions in our breakout groups. So the hope was we could all have a discussion here, but as you can tell, this is such a huge issue and so many facets to talk about. So there's three breakouts. They're all down the hall with signs on the door, you'll see them. We have airport expansion with Air Inc. We have a deep dive into science with Wiggs and Moore and Nalakshi Huda. And then we have building your own filter and school filter questions with Mothers Up Front and NOAA. And then at 7:30, we're gonna come back for Black Carbon and Qigong, taking matters into your own hands. But I do wanna make sure everyone leaves having completed that blue postcard. So make sure you do that. And come find any of us for questions in the breakout groups. Thank you so much, everybody, and thanks to our presenters.